church is going, folks. How y'all feeling today? Something's happening. Something's happening. Again, Ian, thanks for stepping up, brother. Wow. I love that. Someone asked me, what do you love most about being a pastor? And I think what I love most is seeing people step up and win and do things that they can't do on their own. And it's only by the grace of God that you're able to do it. And I love that. That's what I live for. If I could never use a microphone ever again and watch everyone else, I would love it. I don't need to be the guy. I love seeing other people win. For church, we're pumped. This is a good week to get here. We're in our third week of our series, Forgotten Promises. Look to someone next to you and say, don't forget them promises. Don't forget them. Don't forget them promises. Don't forget them. Don't forget them. Oh, I love this series. Last week we talked about the promise of rest. I shared an incredibly encouraging story about the stoning of Stephen. Yay. Super encouraging. But the fact that God delivers and comes through on his promise without fail. Even at the end, at the last breath, he received rest. This week, I am really pumped again. We're talking about a wonderful conversation, the promise of trouble. Someone say, ooh, trouble. Yeah, encouragement. Caleb. Yeah. These pages are filled with more than just stories, ideas, and instruction. Yes, the Bible can instruct you on how to lead a good life. Yes, it has incredible stories. Jonah and the whale, like, it's like crazy what happens. Ideas, philosophical ideas. But one thing that I feel like we don't recognize enough is the fact that these pages are filled with promises for you and for me. Not just like four promises, not the Jeremiah 29:11 that you tattoo on your arm promise. I'm talking like there are so many promises for you and for me. And I don't know if you've been reading the word over the past 3 weeks since starting this. In the first week, I shared kind of like a bonus on how to find the promises of God and just looking for the words, I will. Has anyone been noticing that it shows up all the time in their reading now? Like, I feel like in starting this series, I've been like, okay, there's a promise literally on every page. Every page, there's at least 2-3 promises. It's crazy. These pages are filled with promises for you and for me, and he never fails on one of them. He's faithful and he's reliable. I love what it says in Hebrews 10:23. Let us seize and hold tightly the confession of our hope without wavering. Don't waver. Don't give up. Hold tightly to these promises. For he who promised is reliable. Someone say he's reliable. He's trustworthy. And he's faithful. He's faithful to his word. To his word. He'll never fail. I would just want to encourage you guys, if you're here and you're not taking notes, take some notes today. Because I want to jump into the word and really take this, not just leave it on a Sunday, go home, eat some lunch, and then like check out. But I want to take it with me on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Because we got trouble in this world at times. But he's going to be faithful to his word. He's faithful to every promise written in his word. Everything. Good, bad, and ugly. The promise of trouble, he's faithful to it. The promise of rest, he's faithful to it. The promise of wisdom, he's faithful to it. The promise to never leave nor forsake you, he's faithful to it. So many promises. He's faithful to every one. I love what it says in John 14. Write this down, John 14, 26. But the advocate, the Holy Spirit, this is Jesus talking to you and me, the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you. There's that will. He will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said to you. How will he remind you if you haven't read it in the first place? How will he remind you if you haven't learned it, read it in the first place, heard it in the first place? If you want that promise to be true, you got to jump into the word. He will remind you of everything he said to you. So the whole point of this is this, forgotten promises, remembering all that he's promised you. This series is like 8 weeks, but we could do this for like 94 weeks, and I don't want to take up a year and a half of your time, okay? So we're gonna keep it to 8 weeks here, but the bottom line is this, I can't afford, and neither can you, we can't afford to forget a single word that he said to me. To us, we can't forget. We can't forget. I want to know all the promises. I want to remember all that he said. I want the life that he's designed for me. Well, let us not forget then. John 16:33, here's the point of today. A wonderful promise to you and to me. He was talking to his disciples. Jesus was talking to his guys. He says, hey, I've told you these things. I've warned you. I've told you what's going to happen. I'm letting you know. I'm letting you know that trouble's going to come your way. I've told you these things so that in me, you may have peace. Not in a spouse, not in a lot of money, not in a dream job, not in anything else. But someone say, but in me, in me. In me, you may have peace. In Christ alone. Emmy is not my peace. My kids are not my peace. I love them with my whole heart, but my peace comes from him. In this world, you will have trouble. Sorry. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart. Be of good cheer. Celebrate. Be joyous. That's weird, Jesus. Why would you say that? That's kind of crazy. You have something wrong with you. But be joyous because I've overcome the world. I've solved it. I've given you the victory. There's nothing too great that I can't win for you, no matter how difficult it gets. I've won. So the bottom line for today is this. Only Christ can give us joy in the midst of the most difficult of promised trials. Only Christ can give us joy in the most difficult of promised trials. You can look to other things. There is no other source that's going to give you peace, no other source that's going to give you joy or love like Jesus will. You'll find something that might be like a pseudo joy, a pseudo peace that lasts maybe for a minute or a moment in the midst of your trouble. But if you go to Jesus, you will have peace, joy, overflowing even in the most difficult of times. It will come. The trouble will come. What do you do when it does? It will come. I wish it wouldn't. I wish it wouldn't. But it will. But he can give us joy in the most difficult of promised trials. And so I was praying about this message today and preparing throughout the week. And, you know, I know I'm a comedian. I normally start out with a funny story, okay? And maybe not today. Today, I had a question for all of us that when we may read that scripture, we think about trouble just, oh, life can get pretty crazy. I was studying this word trouble, and I found that there is a difference between temptation and trouble. There's a difference between temptation and trouble. There's a difference between the things that you bring upon yourself and the things that the enemy imposes and tries to oppress and tries to attack you with. So let me give you an example. I get into a lot of trouble as I drink more and more and more. That is a self-imposed trouble. It's me. I chose to do that. I get myself into trouble when that woman or that man reaches out and texts me and DMs me on Instagram and I engage in an inappropriate way. It's me. So there's a difference between temptation, the trouble that comes from temptation, and the trouble that just comes from the enemy and the pressure you may experience. And that's what this scripture is actually talking about. Every week we're going to be studying a word. I know, I got a new Bible software. I'm all of a sudden like a Hebrew and Greek expert, okay? Someone say thlipsis. 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 That's the word that's used here. Trouble, tribulation, or oppression. The trouble or affliction that causes pressure. Outside of you, the things that happen in this world that put a pressure on you. I make stupid mistakes all the time, and I get myself in trouble. Someone say amen. I do that to me. But there's a promise of times in which trouble is going to come to you. Outside, oppression, tribulation, trials that will cause pressure. So I just wanted to make that distinction pretty clear. I'm not talking about the things that I get myself into. Today I'm talking about the things that the enemy wants to press on you. Amen? And so the question that I have for you and for me today, what do we do when we face this pressure? Again, I'm not talking about the mistakes I make that get me into trouble. What do we do when the enemy faces, when the enemy push pressure on us? When there's outside things in our life that we can't control that put pressure on us, what do we do? If you're like me, I don't like trouble, and I'm pretty trouble averse. At the sign of trouble, I'll book it. I don't need any of that. I'm trying to be happy. not trying to have a good life. I'm trying to hang out. I'm not trying to go through trouble, okay? But what happens when the pressure does come? What happens when it does come? I wanted to give you some encouragement from the Word today, what it looks like to face trouble, but how we ought to respond, and what the result is. Here's the interesting thing. Whenever he says, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome. Why would he promise trouble to you and to me? We're going to answer why after this story. If you got your Bible, we're obsessed with the Word here. Go ahead and get your Word out, the book, as Jason would, the book. Come on. Get your book out. Daniel chapter 6. We're starting in verse 3. Come on, Pastor. You should have had this prepared. Daniel chapter 6. This is a story of a faithful man who is threatened for his walk with God. This is a story of a man of faith who was obedient to God, followed him in the midst of a crazy situation, being held in captivity and his land being overtaken. And he was faithful. And all of a sudden, he's under threat because he's been a faithful man, a follower of God. Now Daniel, this is in verse 3. Now Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities. If you know the story of Daniel, he was brought into captivity at a young age because he was smart, he was handsome, all this type of stuff. And over the years, he was elevated because everything that he touched would turn into gold. Literally, he was faithful. He was excellent in everything he did. And here's this moment where a slave and a servant in captivity is exceptional. And the king planned to put a slave over the whole kingdom. That's crazy. We conquered this land, but this guy over here is so great, we're going to put him and make him like the ruler of our land, second to the king. That's wild. And why I wanted to pause and talk about that for a moment is this. Daniel was honoring towards his authority and served in the highest capacity. Just because he walked with God didn't mean that he hated the king and was rude and was a jerk. No, no, no. He was incredibly honoring, and he served. He had that nature about him. It was beautiful. Imagine being held in captivity. You see your people hurting, and yet you choose to honor. That's different. That's different. The story goes on. At this, at the idea of his promotion, the administrators and satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel and his conduct of government affairs. They were getting jealous that some slave was getting promoted. I would be pretty jealous, to be honest. You're going to make this guy? King, we've been with you forever and ever. We're blood here. We're of the same country, and you're elevating this guy. But they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy. I love that. He was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. The others were jealous of this slave and his position. The others were jealous. Daniel, what were we talking about? We're not talking about the trouble inflicted on self. He was trustworthy. He was faithful. He wasn't negligent. He was a good worker. He was upright in all that he did. I'm just trying to mind my own business and live a good life. And you guys are jealous about it. They were jealous of this slave and his position. Finally, these men said, we will never find any basis for charges against this man, Daniel, unless it has to do with the law of his God. Like I mentioned earlier, there's a difference between self-inflicted problem and external pressure. This right here is not a self-inflicted problem. This is not the trouble that comes when Nick Miller messes up and is a fool. This is not the trouble that comes because I mishandle my life. This is the trouble that comes simply from an external pressure that happens from being holy and a devout follower of God. Many people will be blessed by you when you are holy, devout, you walk a good life. When you chase after him with everything you got, you allow the Spirit to grow you and mature you. Many people will be joyous about you, but there will be many who do not like that. Jesus says that they will hate you, but know that they hated me first. And so simply your faith in Christ is going to bring some adversaries that do not like you. This this external pressure is here. This is the trouble that Jesus promises.
Yes.
This is the trouble. So how does he handle this? So these administrators and satraps, follow along with me. They went on as a group to the king and said, "May King Darius live forever. You're so awesome. We love you." The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors have all agreed. Isn't that interesting that two portions of that speak for all five portions? You ever do that? Babe, everyone said I'm the cool. Only your mom said you're cool, bro, okay? Not everyone. These two groups are speaking for all of them. All of us have agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce that decree that anyone who prays to any god or human being during the next 30 days, except to you, King Darius, people need to pray to you. You're a mighty king. They need to pray to you. If they don't do so, they shall be thrown into the lion's den. Now, your majesty, issue the decree and put it in writing so that it cannot be altered. In accordance with the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be repealed. And so he's sitting in front of his group here, all of his advisors. What do? Y'all are saying we do this? I like it. I mean, people are praying to me. That's pretty cool. All right, let's write it. Let's put it in writing. Daniel's authority, by making this decision, placed pressure on him to be disobedient to his foundational beliefs. He was being instructed to pray to a man. The word says that you shall have no other gods before me. So what do? And not only you should pray to me, but if you don't, you're dead. So what do? That's a big trouble, isn't it? That's a big thlipsis. That's a lot of pressure. I don't know, church. I look at this story and I'm blown away by his ability to stand firm and trust God even in the midst of pressure. And here's something that I wanted to say. And here's something that's really been put on my heart. Many Christians today would say bow down so that you can witness to the king or to the community. No. We don't bow down. We don't bow down to anything that is evil. I don't bow down to an ounce of evil. I don't want anything to do with that. The fear of the Lord is the hatred of evil, not who, of. I don't participate with that. You're telling me that I need to pray to a man? No. But you can witness to him. That way you're close to him, and so that way you can speak the gospel, and it's going to be really cool. Love your neighbor. No. I stand firm. I don't bow down. Sorry. I just got to get it off my chest. The authority will place pressure on you to be disobedient to your foundational, biblical, true beliefs. Don't bow down. Don't bow down. Honor, but we don't do and participate with that which is evil. Amen, church? So now when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went to his home upstairs where the windows opened towards Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. How did he respond to a decree that was evil? He said, "Let me open up the windows now and shout really loud what I'm really praying to." Daniel remained faithful and stood firm and did not participate in that which is evil, and actually shouted it from the rooftops. Here I am. Go ahead, try. I won't bow down to that. I'm going to pray to God. That's different. I would be afraid. And I'm the preacher guy. I'd be afraid. I don't know if I could say, yeah, I'm standing firm. That's a different level of faith. Yet that is the example of how we are to respond to that decree. So while he's doing that, he's shouting it from the rooftops. He's clearly not being shy about his stance of following God. And I pray that you would not be shy about your stance of following God either. What ended up happening, though, is the trouble continued. These people went as a group and found praying and asking God for help. Here enters the outside pressure, the trouble that is guaranteed to all believers. Welcome. This is it, the outside pressure. We're going to get into your face. People who've bowed down to this decree, then get in your face about it. Here enters the outside pressure, the trouble that is guaranteed to you and to me. It's a bummer. So they went to the king. They found him being faithful. They found him standing firm. They found him not wavering in the least, holding tightly, seizing those promises, the hope. And so they went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree. Did you not publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or human being except you, your majesty, would be thrown into the lion's den? Remember what you signed, bro? The king answered, "The decree stands in accordance with the law of Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed." Then they said to the king, Daniel, the one whom the king wanted to elevate, the one who was extraordinary, the one who was honoring and faithful, Daniel, who was one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, your majesty, or to the decree that you put in writing. He still prays 3 times a day. When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed, and he was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. He recognized that his faithful servant was about to be in a lot of trouble. The king regretted his decision as he finds Daniel in trouble. That's pretty crazy. Made a mistake. I didn't think he would do it. I didn't even think about it. And all of a sudden, I have this mighty man who's in a lot of trouble. Then the men went as a group to King Darius and said to him, "Remember, your majesty, that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, no decree or edict that the king issues can be changed." And so the king gave the order. King gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. Here's a man who's upright, trustworthy, faithful, and was actually honoring a wonderful guy to his king. And he was thrown into a lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you." Isn't that an interesting statement from the king, that the king actually wanted Daniel to be rescued? "You're so valuable to me. You're so extravagant and extraordinary in what you do. You've brought a lot of value to our kingdom. You've been such a great advisor. I need you. You've been honoring. You've been faithful. You've been such a mighty man. Please rescue you." But there's something that's interesting there. "Whom you serve continually." I pray, this is what I was thinking throughout this week, I pray that people would recognize that I serve God continually, even in the midst of trouble. I think one of the greatest compliments that could ever be said about you or me is that someone comes up and says, "I pray that you would," what did he say? He said that "the God whom you serve continually," I pray that they would recognize that you do serve God continually. In the little things or in the big things, the unseen moments and the moments that are out in front of everyone, I pray that you would serve God continually. I pray that the world would recognize that. And that's a very hard and difficult thing. But I pray that you would serve God continually, even in the midst of trouble. He knew that this was going to happen, even in the midst of trouble. I pray that you would serve God continually. A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, and so Daniel's situation might not be changed. Anyone else remember a stone being rolled over another place? Then the king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him, and he could not sleep. The king was in distress. One of his greatest people was gone. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. He came near to the den. He called to Daniel in an anguished voice, "Daniel." Imagine someone who doesn't really like know you, or your boss addresses you. You get up in the morning. I know Mike works with my dad. So Mike, you walk in and Rich is like, "Mike, servant of the living God, good to see you today." That would be awesome. What a statement. "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?" Is the world going to witness the the power of the living God right in this moment. Everyone has their eyes on this den. All of the advisors, they were all jealous of him. They wanted to kill him. They wanted to get rid of him. This is the only way that they can do it. All eyes are looking at this lion's den. That's an interesting statement. That eyes, and this is kind of like the news, right? Eyes are drawn to trouble. Let me say it again. Eyes are drawn to trouble. What an amazing thing. I feel that God knows that, and he said, okay, we're going to do something here. Eyes are drawn to trouble. Here's a faith-filled man who would follow me to the end of days. Let's put him in this lion's den. Show the world what happens when you're faithful to God in the midst of trouble. All eyes are looking at Daniel. The world's going to witness something here. Daniel answered from inside the tomb. They thought he would be ripped to shreds. Daniel answered, may the king live forever. Isn't that interesting? Wait, you want to see how much honor is in this man's heart? May the king live forever. Even though you're the one who threw me in this little den in the first place, may the king live forever. Again, honor. Honor does not mean that you succumb and you obey that which is evil. But in attitude and in words, you honor. In action, you honor. But we don't succumb to that which is evil. So he was honoring the first moment that the thing was opened. My God sent his angel and shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, your majesty. John 16 goes like this. I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. Here he is sitting with lions that are about to rip him to shreds. An angel came to me and I chilled out for the evening. Had a nice rest. I went to God, an angel came, I had rest. Here we are. Lion's den's opened up. In this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer. May the king live forever. Good cheer. Take heart. I've overcome the world. Please, please, whenever you face trouble that's externally, whenever you're feeling the pressure, choose joy as you face it. It is a joy to face it. It's a joy to face it individually, but also as a community. It's a joy to face it. God's going to show up. When you're faithful, you're obedient, you're trusting God through everything, even in the most difficult of times, God is going to show up. It might not look like what you think it is. He might not do exactly what you envision, but he knows exactly what to do. Amen, church? The king was overjoyed and gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted out of the den, no wound was found on him because he had trusted his God. It requires an immense amount of trust for this, right? It requires an immense amount of trust to follow God in the face of these great threats. I can only stand firm if I truly trust in this promise. And the promise is found in the Word. That's the only way I can stand firm. You really have to trust. Faith, God's word believed. It requires an immense amount of trust. Do you have that much trust? That's a question for me too. Do I have that much trust to stand firm with external pressures that will be coming at me as a promise throughout my life? At the king's command, this is so crazy. At the king's command, the men who had falsely accused Daniel were brought in and thrown to the lion's den along with their wives and children. Whoa, that's a lot, dude. And before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered them and crushed all their bones. The Bible talks of the fact that vengeance is not yours. It's not. God will take care of everything. Vengeance was not in Daniel's hands. God will handle our enemies. God will handle it. God will handle our enemies. That's not up for me to do. I don't need to, well, he lied about me. Look, king, he did it. No. We don't need to point fingers back. Trust God. Live upright. Stand firm. Don't bow down to the pressures. Lean on God with everything you've got, and he will handle every aspect of it. The enemies as well. Do you think if they had lived that they would have stopped trying to put Daniel and kill him? No, they wouldn't have stopped. God put an end to it. And so So here's the question I asked earlier. Why do we experience trouble or external pressure? Talisi, why do we experience this? Nick, this is not fun. I don't want this. Why do we do it, though? Why is this a promise? What did I say earlier? All eyes look to trouble. It's an interesting thing that happens. Look at what the king then does. Then King Darius wrote to all the nations. King Darius, not Daniel, right? You think Daniel could have been the one bragging, I did it, we made it. No, it was actually an unfaithful king who did not believe in the living God. That king wrote to all the nations and peoples of every language in all the earth, may you prosper greatly. I issue a decree, now the other way, I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must fear and reverence the God of Daniel. Not my God, the God of Daniel. I saw something so extraordinary. You better revere that God. That God's real. Keeps going. For he is the living God. He endures forever. Hey, did King Darius have a theological lesson, or is he just observing what Daniel did? This dude wasn't a theologian, and he recognizes that this is a living God, and he endures forever. Bro, he became a theologian in 1 minute. He endures forever. His kingdom will not be destroyed. His dominion will never end. He rescues and he saves. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens on earth. He rescued Daniel from the power of the lions. So Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. What's the result of standing firm? It's going to be really tough. You might be thrown in a lion's den, but ultimately you prosper. And why? And why does this trouble happen? Standing firm and trusting God in the midst of trouble is the greatest form of evangelism. It is the greatest form of evangelism. When you look at evil in the face and you say, I'm not going to bow down. Trouble, and every eye is looking at you. What are you going to do? It's the greatest form of evangelism. Look, an unfaithful king declared the greatness of the King of Kings. He wasn't a theologian. So, can I say maybe a bold prayer then? I pray that you will experience trouble, but lean on him so that the world will see how good the living God is. And I pray for that trouble because I know that you'll have peace, because Jesus says, I will give you peace. Sorry for that prayer. It might be a little bit discouraging, but it's going to bring about a kingdom change. It's going to change the world, and people are going to see how great he is. I don't know how I would feel with this threat of being thrown in the lion's den, but I'm willing to go. I really am. I don't want to, but I am. So then I was thinking, when I preach, I want to make sure that I don't just tell you the story and you walk away with nothing. I actually want to share some ways that we can apply this to our own life. And what I was thinking about this week is the fact that at times, if you're anything like me, we become trouble averse. We don't like trouble, so we run away from it, we avoid it, we ignore it. Whatever it is that happens, we become trouble averse. And we become trouble averse because we might not be fixated or might not understand some biblical truths. And so if I had to say it better this way, if you don't understand some biblical truths, you're going to run away from trouble. You will succumb to the pressure. So it's imperative, if you want to stand firm, that you know biblical truth so that when it does come, you're ready. So I have four things. First one is this. Trouble is where comfort is found the most. Trouble is where comfort is found the most. In the lion's den, an angel visited and calmed everything down. Was an angel visiting yesterday? Not really, but in that lion's den, yeah, an angel did come. Trouble is where comfort is found the most. And then from that place, the comfort that we receive from God, from Christ, is then given to others. It's in fact, I can go and comfort and have compassion and love people because I've been comforted and have been given compassion and have been loved by Jesus. Amen, church? And so we take this comfort and we pass it and share it with others. Praise be to the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. That's who he is. God, who comforts us in all of our troubles. Hey, that's kind of like that's a promise right there. Who comforts us in all of our troubles. Promise. Don't forget. Who comforts us in all of our troubles so that we, why? So that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. Why do you experience this trouble and receive this comfort? So that those who are watching will have comfort too. It's crazy. It's at those points where trouble really comes in that God sweeps in. It's really hard. I want this faith life where like I'm on fire and he's like super present every moment. Like when I wake up, when I eat, when I go to the bathroom, all this time. But usually God is very present and apparent in my life. In those seasons where there's a little bit of trouble, stress, anxiety, he's there and he comforts. Who comforts us in all our troubles. Someone say promise. That's a promise to you and a promise to me so that we can comfort those. And so if you feel a lack of comfort or you want to make sure that nothing bad happens to you, you will be trouble averse. You will not like it. But if you understand that comfort is found even in the midst of trouble, you won't run away from it. Amen? We won't run away from it. We'll stand firm. Trouble is where faith is refined and eternally proven. Faith is refined and eternally proven. Your faith is going to grow, expand, and stretch and mature. That's where it's found. And eternally proven, what I mean by that is you will see when you stand firm in trouble, God does this thing where he reminds you that you're his and nothing can take that away. When the angel entered that lion's den, there was no doubt that Daniel was a man of faith connected to his God. No doubt. And through the refining process, God is praised and honored. Look in this. In all this, you greatly rejoice. There's the take heart. Be of good cheer. Rejoice, though now for a little while you've had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials and troubles. These have come so that the proven genuineness of faith, of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and all honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. What this does is when you rejoice in the trial, it proves the genuineness of your faith and it refines it. When you are, and I'm not a blacksmith, but I've read some things, okay? Whenever you smelt ore and metals and you fashion a ring or a sword, I research swords because I'm that type of guy. When you fashion a sword, what ends up happening is through the heating process, some of the atoms in the sword or in the precious metal actually dissipate into the atmosphere. What he's saying here is that as you face those troubles, as you're refined by fire and molded and turned over and twisted and bent and hurt, none of your faith dissipates. Not one ounce of it. That's pretty crazy. It's greater than that of gold. Gold doesn't dissipate much, but that much. Yours, not at all. When refined by fire and trouble. And what is the result of that? When you make a beautiful ring, when you build a cool Lord of the Rings sword, you're like, wow, that's awesome. When people see that gold ring that is your faith life, that sword that is your faith life, they will revere God and be blown away by him. How can you stand firm during such a great trial and have peace? Only God. Wow. That's different. Faith has grown refined and proven genuine in trouble. Don't shy away from it. We'll be trouble averse if we don't believe that. Trouble is where our character is matured the most. Faith is belief in God's word. Trust in him. This is a little bit different. I'm talking about character. The patience that you have, the steadfastness that you have, the kindness, the goodness, the things that are of the Spirit, this is where this is matured. Growth happens in the trials. More than that, it says in Romans 5, more than that, we rejoice in our sufferings. Again, take heart, be of good cheer in the midst of our trouble, knowing that suffering produces endurance. You know, whenever you get through a trial, you're like, wow, that was crazy, but we made it. We made it. We made it. That's crazy. And then you're like, the next time that, like, okay, so for some of us, we have a hard time having confrontational conversations. We are like, oh, I don't want to address this person. It's going to be really tough. And then all of a sudden, you have that conversation. You're praying. You're leaning on the Spirit of God, and the words are given to you, and you have a wonderful, fruitful conversation. The next time that you need to have a hard conversation, it's easier. You just do it. It actually grows your endurance. It produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. It will change and grow your character and give you hope. You'll find yourself being more patient. You'll find yourself being more kind as you endure these troubles and choose joy in the midst of them. You'll find some characteristics of God that we need to model and emulate and grow into. You'll find that being more a part of your life. Count it all joy. Rejoice in the trial, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let this steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Some other translations would say, so that you are mature. I pray that for you. And here's maybe a bold statement. If you're a person who kind of wants to just chill where you're at for the rest of your life, that's cool, I get it. It'd be easy to chill that way. I will say this, though. If you want to mature in your character and in your faith life, you have to welcome trials. It's one of the biggest growers and maturers of our faith and our character. So if you want to develop and grow, embrace the trouble. It will develop a new character in you. Lastly is this. Trouble is where the enemy thinks he's going to win. He thinks he can conquer you. He thinks he can discourage you and take you away. The truth is that like soldiers, we're called to combat the enemy's schemes. The enemy is going to be present. Even as faith-filled believers, the enemy's not done with you. He wants to keep coming at you and at you and at you and at you again and again and again. I was reading a book, and one of the statements was in the book was like, Western church culture has become very passive, and we do this thing, and he's not talking poorly of praying, but we do this thing where like, we'll just pray about it, hope it all turns out. No, the Word of God is incredibly combative. And when we face trouble, if you look in Ephesians 6, put this up here, this is combative. This is aggressive. Finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. Oh, we'll just pray and be very nice about it. I hope it all turns out nice. No, we wrestle. We fight. No more passive church crap. When trouble comes, we wrestle and we fight it. We wrestle against flesh and blood, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. You and I, we got to fight. And if you don't want to fight or you're not prepared to, we would avoid trouble. We would be trouble averse if we don't want to fight. But the command for believers is to put on the armor so that you will stand. The command is to fight. The command is not to be some passive like, oh, pray God, we'll be all right. No, I'm sorry. If you're a believer, you believe in the way, the truth, and the life. You place your life in Christ's hands. You believe that he died and rose again to set you free and to give you life here on earth and everlasting. You're a soldier and you're a fighter now, period. This passive stuff. Western church culture, no, the enemy's real. We need to fight now. We need to fight now. We need to wrestle against it. How did Daniel wrestle against it? Oh, you're coming at me? Windows open. God, I love you. He fought. He didn't bow down. He fought. And you'll avoid trouble if you don't want to fight. And I don't blame you for not wanting to fight. It is really scary. And it's a lot. But there's a great result when you do. And a life that's unimaginable when you do. When you stand firm through the trouble. And so again, bottom line for today is that only Christ can give you joy and peace in the most difficult of promised trials. They will come. Yay. But Christ is with you. Heavenly joy and peace is made available to you. And no matter what the outcome, I know and I trust that God is victorious. Amen. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for the promise of trouble, knowing that you're going to comfort us, you're going to be with us, you're going to equip us and empower us to stand firm. Not so that we may stand firm for our own life, but so that we may stand firm as the greatest witness to the entire world. God, I pray over each and every person in this room that they would be bold for the kingdom of God, that they would not bow to the troubles, they would not succumb to the evil, but God, that they would stand firm in everything. Give them peace and joy in the good times and in the troubling times. And when they experience pressure, instead of running away from it, may we run to you first. In Jesus' name. Hey, I want to pray for those real quick who need Jesus. I've experienced a world without him, and I know what it's like to face trouble without him. It's awful. You might find peace for a moment in a relationship, in a money, in a dream, and that can be fading. But today I want to offer to you eternal joy, eternal peace, eternal life, even in the midst of every trouble and trial. The amazing thing is that you don't need to be perfect for this Jesus to walk with you and for you to walk with Jesus. You don't need to have your life right. All you need to do is simply believe, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is your Lord and Savior, that he died and rose again thousands of years ago to set you free, and you begin that journey with him on the mountaintops and in the valleys. You walk with him. That's a beautiful thing about our God versus any other God, is that the creator of the universe wants to actually have a relationship with you and walk with you for the rest of your days and into eternity. If you need that Jesus, will you raise your hand on the count of three? One, two. Believers are praying for you. They're not judging you at all. We all need Jesus. Three, if that's you, go ahead. It's okay. It's all right. Well, let's pray for those who have made that decision in their heart. God, we thank you. And if you made this decision, just say this in pure genuineness. Jesus, I need you. I give you my whole life. I'm experiencing the trials and the troubles of this world, and I cannot find the peace. I cannot find the joy. I can find it for a moment, but it's not eternal. And I want to walk and find that eternal joy that we're talking about today, and it's you. I believe that you died and rose again thousands of years ago to set me free and to give me life. And so now, here's my life. Take all of it. I'm walking with you. I turn away from my past. I repent of everything that I've been through, and I'm ready to walk with you for the rest of my days. In Jesus' name, can we lift up a shout of praise for those who made that decision today? Yeah. Will you all stand and sing of a revival?